Hello, and welcome to the Radical Fabulatorium. I'm your host, John Adam Ian. Okay, on today's episode, I sit down with Joel Miller, Juno Award-winning jazz composer, arranger, and saxophonist. Joining us in the conversation is Melanie Leonard. Melanie's been on the show before in the past. She is the musical director and conductor for Symphony New Brunswick. She's also an assistant professor at McGill University's Scollop School of Music. So Symphony MB is teaming up with Joel Miller's jazz quartet to perform some symphonic jazz compositions, which is kind of a cool blend of two different worlds, orchestra and jazz, one very regimented, the other involving quite a bit of improv. All right, so before we get to the chat, just to let you know, if you'd like to support the show, I've got a Patreon I've recently opened at www.patreon.com/theradfab. But here we go, my chat with Joel Miller and Melanie Leonard about the world of symphonic jazz. Enjoy. Yeah, so thanks a lot for joining me, both of you. It's actually pretty new to me to have multiple people in a chat, so I'm kind of excited to see where this goes. And it actually came up last time with my interview with Melanie about how you two would be working together on like a jazz symphonic kind of show with Symphony MB. So maybe, I don't know who wants to kind of like dive into how it got started, but I'd love to know kind of how that relationship formed or how that idea kind of came together. You guys can fight it out. Who wants to answer that first question? But
well, I can start an answer, and then Joel, you can supplement my answer. The exact point of beginning, I can't quite recall. I think it was through Andrew Miller, who plays bass with us, who is Joel's brother. He told me about Joel and shared his contact info. That's from what I remember. And I reached out to Joel and we met and we started just exploring ideas on how we could collaborate. Beforehand, I had familiarized myself with his music and listened to his music. And so I had a better idea. But like so many projects, it just started with a conversation.
Cool. Is that what you remember too, Joel? Did you guys just kind of start, your brother put you in touch, and then you guys just kind of started chatting about what could possibly be?
Yeah. I had actually proposed this to Symphony New Brunswick way back. So I did, when I was doing my master's at McGill University 2016, I was working on symphonic, a symphonic project basically, and that was a lot of what was behind my study at with John Rhea in doing orchestration.
Okay.
So I had lots of conversations with my brother Andrew, who was doing music for silent film. And so when I talked about this, it went through many different phases, and there was a point where Symphony New Brunswick was kind of, they basically sort of left the picture and for a while the changed directors, but I continued the conversation with my brother because we were always talking about music, and he was doing these really neat orchestrating and composing film music for silent film with Symphony New Brunswick. And so when I was talking to my brother about it, he said, well, maybe we should do something with film. And he had all these ideas. And then around that time, there was this excitement because Melanie was going to be the new conductor, and so then it took on a whole thing, because my brother was like, well, why don't you just we put you in touch. So I'm just giving a little bit of backstory to that point. But so I had already seen Melly conducting concerts, and I was really excited because here's someone that's going to do, that's into doing new stuff. So when we met, at there was instantly this excitement about, let's do something.
Cool. That was one of my, so when I interviewed Melanie, when we spoke a few months ago, that's what I enjoyed a lot about hearing, is that I was kind of new to the classical world at that point too. And Melanie, you described like how you were open to kind of bringing in new influences or new flavors into the classical world. Like we even ended up talking about how I felt like I was underdressed when I went to see a concerto or whatever. And Joel, from listening to your music, like it sounds like you do that already with your jazz music. Like I'm hearing like Latin influences. I hear like your latest record, Unstoppables. It's very like visual sounding. You know, does that make sense?
Well, the immediate thing is that it's orchestral.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
and that what the initial setting for that was that it's a symphonic work.
Will you be performing some of that record at the show?
We're performing some of the works from that record.
Okay.
It's not going to be exactly as the record. It's further orchestrated specifically for the orchestra for Symphony New Brunswick. And so jumping back to the conversation with Melanie, so I could have started from here. The part of that conversation that for me was a real kind of gulp moment, in a sense. Like it was thrilling because she was interested. The gulp moment for me was that not only did she want to do the symphony with me, but she wanted to have my group. This sort of brought it. It kind of upped the ante in a way.
Okay.
But of course. So yes, playing the album, it's beyond like playing the album and playing the music as it was intended to be. It's now a jazz quartet, in the way that jazz quartet will function, in the way that they play together,
okay,
and a symphony, and the way that the symphony is together, and the quartet and the symphony being together. So it's beyond like playing this music or playing that music. It's now.
Okay.
The whole thing.
Okay, cool. So it's like kind of two separate worlds coming together to combine to make one unique kind of flavor. What made you, Melanie, want to work with the quartet and not just Joel himself when you guys started talking?
Well, I had listened to his music and I liked the idea of having the quartet, just because I felt it would bring in a more authentic flavor for the jazz side, and they already have chemistry together and they already used to working together, and it's so important. It's important in every kind of music, but jazz having a very prominent improvisational component, you need to have good chemistry with your group, and that comes with time playing together and experience shared together. And it's almost, there comes a point in, I would say even in chamber music for classical musician, but there's a point where you can almost foresee what the other musician will do. At first, we have to really look at one another, but at some point you get to know someone else's improvisational style. and you can kind of anticipate where the person is going and like the arch of their solo and when to come back in with the group. So they already have this, and I wanted to have that because I think it's a unique and beautiful aspect of jazz. And so they will be able to bring that aspect of jazz together. And with the orchestra, we don't have that same reflex of improvisation, at quite at the opposite. Mm-hmm. We have to stay very true to what's on the page. Mm. And I have worked with jazz musicians in the past where so there's two types of solos in jazz, and please, Joel, correct me or supplement my answer because you're the expert, but you can have open solos or closed solos. And so closed solos is both types of solos will follow a harmonic structure of a number of chords, let's say 8 or 16 chords or 8 or 4 or 16 bars. If it's a closed solo, the musician has just that many chords and bars to finish his idea and his improvisation. In an open solo, you take the harmonic structure, but you can repeat it as long as you're inspired. You can go, you could go as long as you want, pretty much. And that's where it's important to understand who you are playing with. You get to anticipate where the solo will end. With an orchestra, it's an added but interesting challenge if it's an open solo, because I don't have that reflex and I don't work with them all the time. So for me, it's going to be about, I'm going to have to always pay attention to the harmonic structure and know where we are in the harmony. Okay. So I know when I reach that chord, it might go on or it might end. So I'll have to look at them and make sure it's really clear, because if you want to bring in 40 people, you can't just nod at them.
Yeah.
You need a very clear sign. So that's what I found interesting. And I really thought that having the quartet being able to showcase their talent in those moments is really going to bring something special and exciting to that collaboration.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, it is really two different worlds. What you mentioned there, like orchestral music or symphonies are like locked into the paper, the way the songs are written. And jazz is kind of known, Joel, for being like this improv, tons of improv involved in jazz music. I guess for some reason, I had never really thought about this performance containing these like open-ended improv sessions. But is that kind of what, so Joel, do you lead those sessions normally when it's time to improv? Are you kind of the one who everyone looks to for cues? Mm-hmm. When it's a quartet situation?
It can be up to me. it depends. I was really lucky in this case. So back to the gulp reaction, bringing not just me but the quartet in it, is that I had just come back to the Maritimes from being in Montreal and COVID, basically. So a lot of my the chemistry that Melanie was talking about with my groups, it's scattered amongst amongst the regions. So the exciting thing about it was an invitation for me to get my chemistry back with my groups. So I immediately saw this opportunity in Fredericton. They have this artist residency at the Fredericton Playhouse.
Okay.
And I just thought, this is perfect, because then I can get the group to get together. And so the recipe for getting that chemistry is playing together a lot. Okay. In Fredericton, I actually have the, I play every week, so I have like a whole pool of musicians that I play with every week, and so we're getting that chemistry. And to make a long story short, the intermission, it's called the intermission artist residency at the Fredericton Playhouse.
Okay,
that was how I was able to get that improvising on the open-ended that you talked about. It takes a lot of trust to answer that question. Yes, sometimes it's open-ended and sometimes things can go. There's a lot of trust that one, egos won't take over, and that somebody's deciding that that's what it's going to go.
Mm-hmm.
And that can happen. And so I've been very busy with on the scores that I'm working on, that each piece has a different way that, so when you're asking about, does that happen in jazz where you have these open-ended things? It can also happen in moderate degrees. It can happen. It's like a spectrum. It can happen 10%. It can happen 70%. Even within a piece, it can fluctuate.
Okay.
So it depends on who you're working with and what you want to do.
Okay.
Some people like to just go open. They don't even like to talk. They just show up on the stage. Jazz musicians that's what they do. They get together. There's no talking. There might be some abstract metaphors or something, and then you go.
Wow.
Even time. I'm not always that type. That's not my thing. It depends on who it's with.
Okay. So keeping that in mind, how does working with Symphony MB, how does that change that approach? Like you must have to decide on something.
Precisely. So it couldn't have happened any better than this because I've been working with a drummer in Fredericton, John Bailey, and we play so much together that we have this real, just the communication is very clear. And in Halifax, there's Silvio Pupo, the piano player that we're both very excited about playing with. I hadn't had played with him in a whole lot of instances, but it turns out that he actually has a very strong classical background. When it comes to classical, I have the least experience out of all the out of the musicians that I picked.
Okay.
And he's very, very free with improvising and improvises. And he's born in Cuba. He studied in classical music in Cuba, so he's part of just a very rich traditions on many levels.
Okay.
Then I had been playing with bassist Adrian Vedati, who it turns out also has a really strong classical. He devotes so much time into volunteering, playing in symphonies because he loves it.
Okay.
But he's also a professional jazz player. He's like the most in-demand acoustic jazz bass player in Montreal. But I moved out. So since I moved out, like around COVID, he's still playing. He's playing with all kinds of groups. So getting him into it, it's just like, oh, this is like so sweet.
Okay, cool. So that's interesting. And
to answer then, so I in terms of Symphony New Brunswick, I knew that, okay, these are people that, like, okay, we're playing with Symphony New Brunswick here. First of all, the obvious one is the drummer needs to know that the touch, like, they can't be a drummer that's going to assume that you're going to put barriers and like be hard hitting. Now, I might have things in the music that sound like they're calling for really hard hitting things. And so I have to then go, okay, so you have to realize that you have to have that energy that's in that type of music, but you're sensitive in the way that you play. So it's like it takes kind of a super, super sensitive musician. So I knew that going into it, that Adrian Vedati, the bass player, like he's going to be the he's going to be the fit for that.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So, cause the dynamics are so important and subtle in classical music, right, Melanie? The way the dynamics ebb and flow are really a big part of the show, really the presentation of the music.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think there's another interesting aspect of playing with a drummer, because the sound of the drum is very direct. And when you play in a smaller group, like a quartet, everybody is used to playing right on the pulse. As with a symphony orchestra, even if we play right on the pulse, there's always a little bit of a delay in the reaction, and the way the sound travels is not a direct sound like hitting a drum. And so that's, but I'm not worried. I'm confident we're going to get used to it. But it is a different type of approach to the beat, or more where you position yourself within the beat, because you can be, I see it as the beat has three positions. The drummer beat, how I see it and how I perceive it on stage when I work with the drummer from being on the podium, is the beat is right in the middle. But you can place yourself, if you want something more anchored or grounded, you place yourself on the heel of the beat. Or if you want something with more momentum, you put yourself at the tip of the beat, and they're not, it's the exact same tempo, but how you approach your sound and the attack and how you want your sound to come out is going to be different.
Okay.
And the drum is direct. That's the nature of the instrument. So maybe for us in the orchestra is we need to take a direct approach to the pulse, but also we hear the drum. So after a few beats, it always comes together. And I guess for the quartet, there might be just the awareness that the sound of the orchestra always comes in a quarter of a second after the pulse. So, but it always comes together from experience. But there is this, and when I worked with jazz musicians or pop musicians, they always have that comment, how at first they're a little surprised by the delay in sound by the orchestra. I had that same challenge when I started conducting, because my beat is where my beat is. You could compare it to a drum, but I was receiving a delay from the orchestra. And so at first I was always slowing down because I was waiting for the orchestra. So it's just a question of habit, I think.
That's really fascinating. Actually, I can relate to that in terms of like recording, voice recording like this, because if you're recording into something with latency and you can hear a slight echo of your voice talk coming back at you, you tend to kind of slow down and start talking slowly, and things get kind of, because your brain's getting these reflections back in it. So that's really fascinating, actually. And that's something I would never have thought about, the orchestra. Like the quartet will maybe be a little ahead of the orchestra just by the very nature of the way the instruments are performed. I'm curious what the members of the orchestra thought when you pitched it, Melanie. Like, did you tell them there's going to be like some improv involved, and maybe everyone's going to be a little outside their comfort zone and they just kind of have to accept it? Or are they excited about that kind of challenge?
They're excited. They're excited. I haven't talked to all of them. I haven't seen them yet.
Okay.
When I discussed this project with the Artistic Advisory Committee, everybody was really excited, and I think the audience is excited as well. And I love presenting different styles of music on stage while still being a symphony orchestra. I think the symphony orchestra is an extremely versatile instrument. I'll call it an instrument in itself as the whole group. And you know, the question of the solos, I think it's just a question of awareness and knowing where the solos happen and if the solos are open or closed. And if the solos are open, then as long as I'm listening and keeping track of the harmony, and I give a very clear cue when the music starts again on the page, I think it's going to you know, it's going to go very well. It's going to be smooth. So it's just a question of knowing what happens in rehearsal and making sure we're comfortable and rehearsing those passages. But I think most of the songs or the pieces, when they're started and we get in the flow of it, it's, and you know, because we have the quartet will also contribute in anchoring the orchestra into the right feel.
Okay. And so how would you, Joel, how would you like be approaching rehearsals in this sense? Like, are you going to have a lot of time to rehearse with Symphony MB? I guess probably not, because it's only a couple weeks away, but.
There's not a lot of time. So so how we approaching rehearsals is that we've had that experience during this artist residency to get our group groove together. So what Melanie was talking about where the beat is and the different places that you feel it on top, or that happens within the jazz, a jazz group is in addition to that. Okay. And a certain bass. So in jazz, it's actually, everybody's different, but I grew up more with pop music. So I gravitated towards the drums, but actually more traditional jazz, it's the bass is the one that provides the drives the bus. It doesn't really matter so much. What Melanie is saying is true, that the drums, it doesn't matter what you think. The drums are like, I can't remember the words you
in the middle. They're right on the beat.
It's just the way that sound travels. It's going. We've already gotten our chemistry as a group with that. So in terms of approaching rehearsals, I'm leading the jazz group, and we're basically being together with like we're going to really use that as a way to feel how like what Melanie was talking about getting used to the adjusting to where the sound that delay that she spoke of, getting used to what that feels like, and then just playing the music, because I know the music. I wrote the music, so I know, like, I've internalized it as much. So it's really, I'm going to be doing kind of a lot of I'm going to be doing sort of leading the band and just making sure that feels good with the quartet, so that we can offer that to the group, so that we're a solid thing. But also listening basically is really what so much of it is what it's about.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because it's kind of like a conversation, right? Yeah, sorry, Melanie.
Yes.
Go ahead.
No, I just wanted to bounce off of what Joel shared. In some of the pieces, I start on my own, and sometimes it's not me, but also Joel knows his music, and his sense of tempo for his music is completely internalized. As for the orchestra, this is a different way of approaching. It's jazz. It's not what we do every day. So there's also an adaptation. We also need to listen. But also, for us, the tempo is not as internalized, because we did not write the music. It's our first time playing it live. So that's also part of the adaptation. And I think when Joel says we need to listen, it's also, it's a give and take. If you feel at some point, you know, we're two clicks too slow, he's going to feel it. Mm-hmm. But sometimes the orchestra is just, it just goes two clicks under, because, and you know, what we're going to do at the dress rehearsal is going to be one thing. And then at the show, some pieces might go faster or slower, just because if they feel in the moment and how we react in the moment to the pulse. But that's also the beauty of it. It keeps it exciting.
Yeah, I mean, I'm kind of excited just hearing you describe the process. So is it going to even be important where the quartet sets up on stage, thinking about the delay that happens with the symphony? Does that come into the planning process?
Not really. They're going to be in front.
Okay.
Of the orchestra.
Okay. Cool. So, go ahead.
Yeah, we brought out the measuring tape in the playhouse because my thing is is there going to be enough space? It's not so much the placement of where we are. Well, we have an idea of where the sweet spot is. Mm-hmm. That we'd like to be. My thing is there going to be enough room to do that? But I'm trying not to I'm trying not to worry about that.
Okay, so just so it's clear to everyone, maybe we should mention who's in the quartet. And so it's going to be drums, bass, piano, and yourself playing saxophone. Does that make up the quartet?
Acoustic bass, he uses a little amp just in case he needs to have that extra sort of oomph.
Okay, cool.
You probably wouldn't even notice because it's not like going through the board. Like it's just so that it's kind of like a little extra turtle. No, I'm kidding. So
a little game boost.
And then the acoustic piano and like, you know, with the half stick, like with the lid probably not completely open. And grand piano, hopefully tuned just before. And then myself with saxophones. I probably won't be using a microphone. I'd like not to. And then drums, just placed just so. A drum kit. So yeah.
Anyway. Cool. Yeah, that's really cool. So you'll be playing some of your original music, but you'll also be doing some standards. Is that right?
Well, it's mostly Joel's original compositions that we're going to be playing. We're going to be playing in terms of standards. We have Gershwin, Summertime, and there's also an arrangement of it's a Schubert, the Ave Maria.
Okay.
And should we tell them the surprise we have for an encore, or should we leave it a surprise?
you could. I can keep a secret, so you can tell me, and then I'll keep it to myself. That's a joke.
Chad is going to walk out on stage. So we're going to do Pink Panther.
Oh, cool! Yeah.
Yeah. It's fun.
Absolutely. And so is there going to be like, that's really interesting. So what do you expect? Do you have any sort of like expectations with like the way the crowd will experience the show?
I think they will love it.
Yeah.
I think it's so exciting. And, you know, I think it's great also in different musics like this. I'm not the type of classical musician who, you know, I don't mind if people clap in between movements. I think when people are happy and they express it, that's part of it. You know, we share music because we actually hope that people will receive it in their heart and be happy about it. Mm-hmm. But what I love about jazz or pop concerts is the energy is completely different. Even though the enthusiasm is going to be on the same level, it's expressed differently. People react right away after each piece, and they're going to clap. And, you know, it's just, it's, I don't know how I would put it, maybe a more lively or outwardly express immediate joy after each piece. It's just a different energy. I guess there are different ways of expressing joys, but but I like the energy.
What about you, Joel? Do you kind of agree the energy is, because it is kind of two different worlds with different energies coming together?
I think it would be good to express that that basically, yeah, my hope is that the audience feels like they can show their appreciation clapping in any way that they want to, and that it doesn't feel. I mean, jazz has an etiquette of its own where people do solos and then you clap after the solos. And it's funny, actually, my brother Andrew, when he heard my group one time, he was like, you know what I really like about your group is that people don't feel like they need to clap after the solos. And then I was like, that's odd. But then I realized that that's what was cool, is that there's different places. Like, it doesn't just do the expected thing. It's kind of like in Montreal, I've noticed there was a period with a lot of bands where you didn't do an encore. It just didn't feel like everybody had to do an encore. And after a while, it just became like, okay, I want to go home to, like, yeah. Why is this expectation for the encore all the time?
Okay.
And it's like a concert that feels like, yes, it's all wrapped up. And then people want an encore. It's like, no, that was just like, the meal was just perfect.
Yeah.
I'm hoping that people will pick up on that, and they'll also pick up on just how we're together, and that it's my hope is that it doesn't come off as like, oh, now you have to jazz, oh, and then here's the classical thing, and I want so that people come out of it where it's like, wow, that's really neat. They can go together, and like, it's sort of inspiring for things in people's lives that might not necessarily be music and work, or just ways of it's a type of value for me of being together.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm hoping that the audience will pick up on that.
Absolutely. Yeah. That's really interesting. And it's funny, as you mentioned, like the clapping after a solo. So in jazz, people can be clapping while the music is still playing. And then, like, one thing I found interesting about classical is that a movement will end and it sounds like the song is over and there'll be just no clapping at all. So yeah. That's this is such an interesting mix of two worlds. Everything about the world, they're kind of like opposites. So, like, I'm personally really curious to hear it.
You know, I think we could say, in jazz, the audience is invited to improvise as well, you know?
Would you agree, Joel?
Yeah. Yes, precisely.
Yeah. So the audience is taking, because Melanie, last time we talked about how you could kind of feel the energy, even though your back is to the audience and you're conducting,
mm-hmm.
you could feel the energy in the room, and that would affect your performance or like kind of the way you're communicating with the orchestra. So Joel, how does that affect you? Can you feel the energy in the room, and like what... How can a crowd kind of control your performance?
Yeah, well, I remember playing with this band that we had. It was all original music, and there was one part in the song where it was just kind of like it had this something about it. Whenever we finished, whenever we got to that place in the song, people clapped, and it was so neat because it added this whole thing. Like it was like, I didn't know that the song was that until that happened.
Okay.
It's so much, feeling the it's like Melanie said, they're players, they're improvising the emotion of how things are landing,
mm-hmm.
and, how things land with the audience affects us and it lifts it in it.
Okay. And another thing too, I talked to Melanie about before, was that when I went to see a classical music performance, so I'd been trying to listen to it, and I knew some of the popular pieces, but it was when I was in the room feeling the music, you know, that it kind of clicked in my brain, like, oh, okay, I kind of get a sense of this now, like this is making sense to me now. How do you feel about that with jazz, like the difference between taking in a jazz recording and experiencing it live in the moment, in the room?
World difference.
Totally.
because it's improvising, and that's the whole thing about jazz recording. How is it even jazz? Because it's no longer improvised. It's captured.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's, you could be playing and then an ambulance goes by outside and then, oh, that's in the music now.
That's part of the performance. Wow.
There's somebody that like in the audience that like, you know, feels moved to like, you know, yell out like, yeah, or something at this one part. Like that only happened, that it's only happening at the time. So yeah, it's a completely different, it's, I mean, the now is everything.
Okay. But, that's interesting. So would recording jazz music, is that kind of viewed as a compromise or something? Like, cause you want the product to be out there, right?
I don't know the answer to that question. And that's the neat thing about jazz is that despite all that, there's records that are just, I listen to them over and over again. And so it's, what would have been, how would it have been being in there in the studio as that happened? I don't, there's, it's just that both things are there and they're both amazing. I mean, there's some great jazz albums that they're just magic that way. Mm-hmm. It's a different thing.
Okay. Yeah, that's interesting. So that is actually kind of one similarity between the two, is that the recordings, because recordings of classical music don't really, I mean, they're beautiful and they sound good, but like they don't really compare to being in the room. Maybe that goes across all music, but maybe this is one moment where these two worlds are kind of similar, where you kind of you should be in the moment experiencing it to really appreciate it fully.
Yeah. And under recording, you don't get the human experience of live concerts. Because in the audience, the audience is also, there's an entity on stage, but the audience is its own also entity. And both of them create a synergy. Mm-hmm. And so you feel that as part of the experience. You don't get that from a recording.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and kind of what you said, Joel, about an ambulance going by, that's such a fascinating insight. Because it really does become, I mean, people hear it, music's playing, it becomes part of the show. Or someone dropping bottles or knocking something over, all of a sudden that's part of the performance. So this is obviously exciting. Like I'm excited just thinking about going to the show, but is there, I'm curious to hear if you guys are kind of scared or if there's any fear involved in this idea as well, if you feel like getting vulnerable.
Well, there's always I would say that's the same for every concert. There's always a little bit of apprehension before the very first rehearsal, because even when you're playing something, you know, you just, it's always, okay, I hope this goes well. I hope we get into a good rhythm in the rehearsal. I hope it feels to everybody that we're accomplishing great work. It's fulfilling. And as we keep working, we're getting more and more excited for the concert. So before you played that first piece, or there's always you haven't experienced it yet. So there's an unknown, mm-hmm, that you need to manage. But I would not say it's a stress that stops you from sleeping at night. It's a mix of apprehension and excitement at the same time. It's not necessarily feeling nervous or anxious about them, about the rehearsal, but a little of... There's always a little bit of discomfort with the unknown, mm-hmm, until you actually experience it. So I guess it's more that than anxiety.
Okay. How do you feel about it, Joel?
Precisely, yeah. At the risk of just saying what you said about it, it's, I think the fears are the, all the kind of practical stuff. Will my reeds be dried out on my saxophone? What if I drop one of my instruments? All these sort of practical things. I think for me, there's so much internal stuff to do this. It's music that I've composed over my whole life. The pieces go back, like some of the pieces that we're doing, I began like 20 years ago.
Okay, cool.
So There's so much. It's so personal. I feel good about that, and I feel like I trust all the people that that are involved, and it feels really good. It's more just like the the physical world things, what if there's a snowstorm, all these types of things. But a snowstorm is probably the beginning of March so the thing is, I composed this music and I've orchestrated, so that's like the fact that it's being played. I've never played saxophone with a symphony ever.
Okay.
I've never actually composed or orchestrated this music on this scale ever.
Okay.
It's huge. It's a huge thing. But the fears are more just like making sure that everything works so that it can go, and of course there's also just the, what am I going to do when it's over? Like, what's life going to be when this is?
It's like an astronaut going to space. Where do I go now? So okay. So the fear, the technicality, I could see that being. There's nothing you can do about that, though. I guess you just kind of go in the moment. And usually, when there's fear involved, there's growth involved. So you know you're going to be kind of in this really amazing learning experience, right?
Yeah, for both of us.
For sure.
But I think also because I'm reflecting on what you just said, those pieces and the time you've put composing them and how much they've been a part of your career for a long time. Like you accumulated a list of pieces that you composed, and this is giving them a new life or a different life. It's bringing these compositions into a new universe. And in that sense, even if it's on paper, the creation process keeps going during the rehearsals because we are creating that universe together, the orchestra and the jazz quartet, and bringing to life your compositions in a different way.
Yeah, that sounds really, really exciting. So things could change in the moment because it's such a brand new idea anyway. So when you were orchestrating them, Joel, were you doing that all by yourself, or did you work with Melanie to help, which pieces of, like, which melodies are going on which instruments, or who's taking the top line, or any of that kind of stuff?
Yeah, good question. When I began the orchestra, first of all, there was the possibility that, I could just write something entirely new. Putting that upon myself but when the jazz quartet piece came into it, it became more, okay, let's work with what's really more familiar here. So what I did was I immediately got in touch with Professor John Rayo, who I did orchestration with when I was doing my master's. So he really knew, he kind of knew what he worked on all the orchestration with me before, in producing that album Unstoppable. So I immediately reached out to people that I trusted with orchestration, and then he recommended someone that actually lives in Moncton right now, Jason Noble, who was at a student of John's, and I couldn't have been a better person for this. Like, he just, we immediately clicked on these scores, and the things that he brought out were just these subtle things with the music. So I really took my time with him and just absorbed as much of how to orchestrate each one so that it really matches the piece and everything. So I got coaching in orchestration on top of the studies that I did when I did my master's. And then in terms of like the actual scores, I had an editor that I got to that's familiar with the jazz side of orchestration in terms of like what, because part of me was kind of like, I don't even want to include the what the quartet is doing on the scores for Melanie, because it's just so, it's so much like what we just do. But Chris really pulled it back and it's like, Melanie needs to know, she needs to know what you're doing, like what. So I really had to like go out of my comfort zone with that and just like notate like as precisely as I can what this quartet is going to be doing, even though it's like there's improvising and there's all these things, but it's like you gotta communicate that so he helped just like with the visual, like how things are going to look on the page, and because we're dealing with scores, the orchestral scores, and tons of parts where I had help with that, but that was pretty much it in terms of of course the having the opportunity to develop the music with the quartet. Mm-hmm. So it's sort of like a test trial. And when I rehearsed with the quartet during Fredericton and the intermission or it was residency, I brought in musicians from the orchestra and we played through. So yeah, this is actually, so
cool.
Getting to the scores, yes, I'd help with that. But what is key is that Symphony New Brunswick has like different satellite groups within the orchestra. So there's like the woodwinds form a group, the strings form a group. And so I was able to work with those groups during the space of like a year.
Okay.
And actually perform them. And of course, on a writing level, it was kind of infuriating, not infuriating, but it was like a whole load of work, because I would write all this stuff, bring it into that group, and then that would give me more ideas. So then I would go back to the scores, and then, but it was more ideas on how to get to the essence of things, not to like bring in, like not to complicate the whole process was like really trying to get to the essence of what I'm trying to say with these pieces, not, oh, what if I try this? What if I try that? No, because it's like, we don't want things to, I mean, there's a certain element of that, but mm-hmm. only so much rehearsal time. Mm-hmm. It has to be very clear.
And the timbre of each different section in the orchestra, I mean, you could give each section the same melody, but it's going to feel different just based on the timbre, the way the sound waves are coming out of the instruments.
Yeah.
It's like painting. It's orchestration is like painting, and each instrument is a color.
Okay. And you can mix and blend them together.
Yes.
Okay. So I was going to ask you, Joel, too, that kind of what you just said kind of rolled into, I'm always kind of fascinated by like the blending of the technicality versus making the decision based on the feeling. So like, it sounded like that's what you were probably struggling with as you were, or maybe not struggling with, but working out when you were going through the different sections as you're trying, you've got technicality, you've got, you know what this, the parts are supposed to be maybe, but then I guess what I'm trying to ask is how many decisions are made based on feeling and how many decisions are made based on technicality, like technical theory?
it's really kind of both of them wrapped up. It's like, it's feeling, but you know what the instrument's like. Okay. You could have a feeling that a tuba is going to go blah, 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 you could have a feeling that a tuba could sound like an oboe, mm-hmm. but a tuba can't sound like an oboe. So it's just like, it's kind of like, you work with that feeling. Maybe the tuba could do this other thing, but it is a tuba. So it's like, there's a technical, and not only is it a tuba, but you've got a tuba and you have like, I don't know, a violin, like, you know, so it's the feeling is already kind of in the subject of the music. It's how do you bring that out? Like the feeling, it's getting to the essence of the feeling is like what the song is. Like if the song is like a fun thing where it's like there's humor in it, then bring that humor out with whatever technical, like whatever ways are possible with that. Like, and if the feeling is like ethereal or something, then it's kind of both of them wrapped up. There's always like feeling and intent of the whole thing is about feeling. Mm-hmm.
Did you have anything you wanted to add to that, Melanie? I do. It does all come down to feeling, but I just always find it fascinating the way that, because some people would make those decisions based on technical or theory, and then when you're in the moment, you realize maybe you haven't quite chosen the right path or something like that.
Well, I guess it's just a question of when you know, because every instrument has its own sound and technical particularities. For instance, one example I like to give is oboe. Playing in the lower register at an extremely soft dynamic is extremely difficult, and the instrument has a physical limit. It's never going to be able in that same register to play as soft as a clarinet, let's say. And a flute in the mid-register, well, depending what else is going on in the orchestra, you might not hear it because it's not a register at which the flutes project very powerfully. Mm-hmm. So I guess it's when you have your idea or your feeling, you know what you're trying to convey, but knowing what instruments would be the best choices to convey that idea within their strengths and, I don't want to say limitation, but their technical particularities, then you can make the right choice to convey your feeling. Because even as Joel said, even if you're hearing something, let's say, shrilling, the tuba is not going to be the best instrument to convey that idea. Mm-hmm. So it's a question of that also, is you need to know a little bit about every instrument's particularity to convey your idea, but also to give them a meaningful voice, because you want them also to be expressive at the best of their capacity, both the musician. If you respect the particularities of the instrument, the musician will feel way more free and it's going to be way more enjoyable to play that line that you put in their part than if you write something that's at the complete limit, borderline over the limit of that instrument. It's not going to be comfortable to play and it's going to be really hard to actually convey the feeling you want them to convey. So
okay,
they work hand in hand.
Okay. Yeah, you do obviously have to keep in mind the human performer that's presenting a piece of art. Yeah. Okay. Does that come into play too, Joel? To be honest, I'm not really familiar with saxophone. So you play various types of saxophone, or is it for timbre reason, or is it for mainly for range reason when someone will be playing different saxophones?
Both timbre. Yeah. I think of it as character.
Character. Okay.
Yeah. So I will be bringing, I'm playing three saxophones. So my tenor, alto and soprano. And they're each song has a different character. And I choose the, I choose the saxophones according to what tenor sort of my, probably about 70% of it is on the tenor.
Okay. Would you ever change midway into a song? Like, would you be swapping out saxophones through a one song? Yeah.
There's one song that I do that, and it's funny. Like I just kind of got used to doing it, and I still don't really know if it's weird or not. I don't usually do that. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I try to, and of course, some of it at a certain point in writing all this stuff, I'm like, I gotta take a, there needs to be a break from saxophone here. So I thought about that quite a bit too. Like how to remove myself. And that's something that's a personal sort of thing. I talk to a lot of jazz players that orchestrate it too. And talk about that. It's like balancing how much of yourself or your instrument, because I actually don't listen to, I don't always like to have the saxophone in music. So, mm-hmm. That's definitely something too.
Okay. Yeah. I can see that. Yeah. That's, too much of a good thing, but you don't want much of a good thing.
Or just the appropriate, the appropriate sound.
Yeah. Okay.
Because I really like, all kinds of color. Melanie talked about the palette. I like all kinds of things, and I might want, the exciting thing for me with this is that strings, I kept reminding myself, we've got these strings, use these strings as for the way that you want it. This is a conversation myself, but, mm-hmm. And so it's sort of balancing between something that's new and using it, how to use it to the best expression to get that feeling, like you said,
take advantage of the situation and use it to its full potential. Are you going to take the opportunity to record the performances?
No, well, we can possibly do an archival recording, but this is, it's not something we can share with the public. When we do an archival recording, it's more like a tool, or we'll do that for composers when they have a premiere of their works, or they can listen to it, but it has to remain private. So unfortunately, it's not something we would be able to share with anyone.
Oh, okay. That's just is that for legal reasons or
Yes.
We don't have to get into it, but yeah, that's interesting. But yeah, it'd be cool. It'd be cool. At least you'll have it as keepsake, right? A memento? Is that maybe a way to look at it?
Yeah, that's more it. Yeah, because recordings are different contracts than live performances.
Oh, okay. Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I'm not used to that world really. In I come from a rock and roll punk rock world, so if people just kind of record whatever they want, and it is what it is. But those orchestral musicians would all be kind of union members and everything, right?
Yes.
Yeah, cool. That's a whole other fascinating side of the business.
It also becomes something else if it's a recording project. I would love to record it, but not now. Mm-hmm. And in a way that's it puts a whole other thing onto it, imposes a whole other thing onto it, because are you playing to experience the music for the audience and be in and out, or are you doing something for a document? So yes, I would love to record it. If first of all, it's like Melanie said, that's a whole other contract. It's also a whole other reason for doing what you're doing.
Yeah, very valid points, because you got to think about fidelity. And I know earlier in the conversation you mentioned that you hoped you weren't even going to be using a microphone.
Well, that's to do with the sound also. A part of this whole thing for me is about communicating with sound and wanting to get to the somebody's acoustic sound, the acoustic sound for example, playing in a section like an orchestra, when trumpets, for example, when they're playing, if you have or in a choir is probably the best example, when you you've experienced being in a choir, and when you hit certain, like a harmony together, and you get that zing, mm-hmm. like there's an actual, I mean, there's physics to this and everything, but you don't necessarily get that when there's a microphone involved, and you might get it in a certain way, but it just adds a whole other dimension to it that if I just rule it out, I mean, yes, I want to be heard. Like that's what the microphone, if somebody can't hear the saxophone, then maybe there can be a microphone, but anyway, it's more than just, it's a lot of things for me. It's really important to me that the sound comes out of your instrument, and that's the thing that you're sharing, you're communicating, and everyone that listens to that plays in their way because they're hearing that sound the way you're intending it to come out, not necessarily the sound that the sound person, whether you want the sound person to do this or not, but if the sound is coming out of another speaker, that somebody might be listening to that sound, and it could be really cool. It can actually, I've been in performance situations where that's the thing, but there's enough stuff going on that it's like more about ruling things out, because there's three trumpets, there's three trombones, there's so much sound going on.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a very personal thing for me, but amplification.
Okay. Yeah, I love that. I mean, in some way, a microphone kind of is like another barrier between the listener and the performer in some way, because it is, like what you just said, there is physics involved. The sine waves are all blending together in a certain way. What if the microphone is picking up the saxophone and it's coming out of the speaker over there and the sound guy's turning it up? Well, now he's affecting the way the sound waves are, or the sine waves are all bouncing around the room. So that's fascinating. Yeah.
Or not. And yeah. And the microphone is a whole thing. There's ways to use microphones and there's ways to play in microphones. And I'm not like a purist and say, no microphones. It's not about that. It's just, an element that just has the potential to set things off balance.
Yeah. Cool. That's really interesting. Okay. So, and you've got three shows, right? You're going to be doing Moncton, Fredericton, St. John.
That's correct.
Starting in St. John, I do believe, right? At the Imperial Theater.
Yes.
And that's going to be on, that's the Monday, right? March 3rd. I got that right?
Yes.
Cool.
Yeah. It's on a Monday.
Oh, sorry. March 4th.
March 4th and Monday. Yeah.
So yeah. That's exciting. Yeah. So I know we're like, it's 2:45. So we've already been at it for over an hour. Believe it or not, time seems to fly, but, so we're going to be at the Imperial on the Monday, the 4th.
Correct. Yep. Fredericton the 5th at the Playhouse.
And then Capitol in Moncton.
On the Thursday, the 7th.
Okay. Cool. Yeah. So I'll put links. I mean, I'll do like a proper introduction before it goes out, and I'll give out all that information for people who want to snag tickets. Is there anything you want to shout out or anything you want to talk about that I didn't touch on or to add to the conversation before we wrap it up?
Not really. I think we covered pretty much everything.
Yeah, it was really fascinating for me. I learned a ton, so I kind of feel like I feel kind of spoiled to be able to pick your brains.
Right on. Yeah. I guess if I was to add anything, it's that this, I feel like this is kind of the beginning in a sense, because there was so many things that I, in a sense, with this experiment, you mentioned punk rock, like I played in punk bands. I used to write music or compose music with my friends in punk bands.
Oh, cool.
I had those songs. I have a band that mixes like jazz and bluegrass and there's so many things that could be brought into this. So I just wanted to say that it's really, it's not so much like a perfection thing. Like it, that this whole thing where it's like I have this opus, and it's going to be like I've been dreaming of this thing, and like it's going to be this way. It's really like I feel like it's a beginning of a relationship in a way. Like it's there's so many ways, and like I want the conversation to continue, and how, I mean, I know that there's orchestras that are doing reggae music in, there's like, it's a whole thing. Like it's a whole thing where it's like, and I love reggae music, and I love symphonic music, and how is that going to sound? And there's like the stuff that Paul Simon's doing, and there's he's incredible. So I really I'm really excited about this whole thing, and just how it's like a beginning in a sense.
Cool. Yeah. It's kind of like, it's not like you've scaled a mountain. It's kind of like you're at base camp. You've accomplished one part of it, but you're still got plenty of room to climb. Do you feel the same way, Melanie? Do you want to do more collaborations like this in the future?
I would love to.
Yeah.
I would love to, because even if I'm a classically trained musician and I love the classical, like the regular symphonic repertoire, when I listen to music, I'd say I listen to a lot of jazz actually. And one of my favorite albums is Night Train by Oscar Peterson. Mm-hmm. I listen to this one a lot. Gerald Morton as well. I like old jazz from the 20s and the 30s.
Oh, cool.
As well. Yeah. So, yeah. So having a chance to participate in these projects is exciting to me. And my very first professional symphonic gig was actually at the Montreal Jazz Festival. And
cool.
Yeah, so jazz came into my life in an unexpected way mm-hmm. at that time, but I love it, and I love every type of music, and I listen to pretty much everything. So having the chance to do different things on stage and approach different repertoires and collaborate with different artists is really exciting and nourishing. Mm-hmm. And also reaching out to the audience in different ways and sharing different things with them. And maybe there's some people in the audience that don't come usually to symphonic music, but they love jazz and they'll be there for that. So it's a chance to communicate with new people through music as well.
Yeah, that's a beautiful thing. That's one of the best parts about music, right? And like before the interviews on my show, I'll play maybe an hour of music, and like all any of my listeners know, I'll play like either, it could be like really heavy black metal, and then it'll go to an acoustic, like a Paul Simon tune. And then I might play some like electro pop, like some dance music. So the variety is really what it's all about.
Yep.
Cool. All right. So I'm really happy you guys both took the time, Joel and Melanie, to sit down and chat with me. I'm grateful for it. I really appreciate your time.
Thank you
for having me.
Yeah, no problem. And anytime you want to come back, Joel, if you're ever in the city and you want to swing by the station or whatever, just drop me a line and we can do it again.
Sounds good.
And yeah, I'll be at the show. So hopefully I can maybe I'll put a blast out on social media before I head into the venue.
Sounds good.
Thank you.
Yeah, no problem. Thanks a lot.
Thanks.
See ya.
Thank you.